tutorial problem, we are numbering them sequentially. 1 to 10 was given yesterday. Today we will start with number 11. So, there is a long cylindrical fuel element in a nuclear reactor. There is energy generation which occurs uniformly. The diameter of the rod has been given to us. So, so diameter has been given to us as 25 mm, and there is a thin aluminum cladding. So, there is a thorium rod and then there is a cladding made of aluminum. This is aluminum, this is thorium. This diameter has been given to us. It is proposed that under steady state condition, system operates with a volumetric heat generation rate of 7 times 10 to the power 8 watt per meter cube, and H, T infinity are also specified. So, H is 7000 watt per meter squared Kelvin and T infinity is 95 degree Celsius. So, we are asked to find for safe operation the clad outside surface temperature should not exceed 600 degree centigrade. So, this is the limit on the outside surface temperature. So, we are asked to find whether this cooling condition is acceptable, is satisfactory. That means, with this given amount of cooling H and T infinity, will the amount of heat generated be taken out so that the temperature on the outer surface of the clad is not going to be greater than 600 degree centigrade. So, where is the clad? This is the clad, this is the cladding aluminum. So, on the outer surface of the clad, we should not have temperature greater than 600 degree centigrade. So, it is a simple problem where we are going to deal with energy balance only. So, list of assumptions we will write. We are dealing with steady state. Known constant properties,
1D radial conduction,
one dimensional conduction in radial direction, outward radial direction, 1D radial conduction, uniform. Now, you will appreciate what is why this assumption is very important. There is flow of air from this side, let us say. We know for a fact that H is going to vary, but we are going to assume uniform H and T infinity, known constant uniform volumetric heat generation rate. Then you have, this is a no contact resistance between the fuel element and the cladding. So, if I apply energy balance E dot in minus E dot out plus E dot generated equal to E dot stored, this goes to 0 because of assumption 1, which is steady state. You do not have energy coming in, you just have energy generation and that has to be transported out. So, there is no energy coming in, therefore, E dot G is equal to E dot out. E dot G is being given to us in the form of a volumetric heat generation. So, let me write that. Q dot is given to me as 7 times 10 to the power 8 watt per meter cube. Volume of the cylinder, I do not know the length. So, we can do the calculation per unit length basis, per unit length basis we will do. So, I will not get total Q, instead I will get Q prime, which is Q by L, that is nothing but Q dot times pi r squared. So, pi r squared, L is the volume, I bring the length here. So, I get the linear heat rate. This r is the fuel element radius, not the clad. Okay. So, this comes out to be Q prime comes out to be 7 times 10 to the power 8 times pi into 25 by 2 times 10 to the minus 3 whole square, 12.5 millimeter and this is nothing but 3.4361 times 10 to the power 5 watt per meter. Okay. So, this is the linear heat rate. This has to be removed. What happens if there is heat accumulation? Temperature is going to rise. So, we want to see at steady state with this convective heat transfer coefficient on the outside. We do not know what is the outside temperature of the fuel element. This is the clad. We do not care about this. We are just worried about this being T naught. This obviously calculations would have come from safety aspects of the fuel. We are not concerned with that, but we know for a fact whatever heat is generated has to go out, and this is the clad. So, Q prime therefore is equal to H pi D clad out times T out minus T infinity. Why D clad out? Why pi D? It is actually pi D L, but that length has been taken here because this is Q prime, that is Q by L. So, pi D clad out times T naught minus T infinity. This value is given to us as 600. So, H pi D clad out T infinity minus 600. So, we will substitute for that. Substitute, we can do one of two things. We can substitute for H pi D clad out 600 minus T infinity. We will get a value of linear heat rate. That linear heat rate, if it comes to be, if Q prime now comes out to be less than Q prime calculated, that means this cooling arrangement is not sufficient. Conversely, we can put the value that of Q prime calculated earlier and estimate that T naught or the outside surface temperature. If T naught comes less than 600, we are safe. If it comes greater than 600, we are unsafe. So, let us do, we have done, we have used this value. So, that is 3.4631 times 10 to the power 5 watt per meter is equal to H 7000 into pi into 0.025. Why we are using the same dimension? Essentially because thickness, it has been told, is negligible thickness or very thin aluminum cladding. So, we are using this as same as D naught of the fuel element into T out minus T infinity. So, from this if I calculate, I get T surface comes out to be 725 degrees centigrade, which is much greater than 725 degrees centigrade. This is T naught, which is greater than 600 degrees centigrade, which is permitted. Therefore, the cooling arrangement is poor or not satisfactory. How do we increase this? The only way logically probably is to increase the value of the heat transfer coefficient, so that effective heat removal is going to take place. So, some of you can try the other thing, put 600, see what is the Q. It has to come out to be lower than 3.463 times 10 to the minus 5 watt per meter. Okay, so, we are doing these kind of simple problems in the beginning just to emphasize the concept of energy balance.
Now, we will shift to questions for some time, maybe for next 10 minutes. So, what we would encourage you to do is, you be solving the problems. We will handpick any random problem out of 11 to 20 and then solve, but please be solving while we are taking questions from various centers.
So, yesterday we had requested the coordinators to take a look at the solve tutorials from all participants today. So, I hope that was done and almost all of them have solved all the problems that was assigned yesterday. So, if that is not the case, please let us know. There could be multiple reasons that either they are having difficulty, in which case we need to address that issue, or if people are having other problems, we need to address that also. Okay, so which college will go?
Could you please explain how the Heisler charts are constructed?
Heisler charts, I think, okay, so that is very good question. One of the participants' question is, how are Heisler's charts constructed and how are they different from the analytical solutions which have been shown? Okay, so that means we have not connected both of them. So the analytical solution, what was shown, let me re-show that. So this is the analytical solution. So using this analytical solutions only, we are plotting what is there on the x-axis and what is there on the y-axis of my charge. In the y-axis, I have T minus T infinity upon, let me show that. Yeah, what is that? What is that we are showing? So here, what is there? This is Fourier number and this is 1 by Biot number and this is theta naught. What is my analytical solution telling? Analytical solution is telling that this theta is a function of Biot number. How? Directly I cannot see. This lambda 1 is a function of Biot number. This is the solution of the transcendental equation. So for a given Biot number, I will get lambda 1, that is the first root itself. If I take only the first root or even multiple roots, I get, for a given Biot number, I will get lambda 1 and A1. If I plug in that lambda 1 and A1, I can construct temperature as a function of x and T minus T infinity minus T I minus T upon T I minus T infinity. To answer your question, the chart is nothing but the graphical representation of this equation. So in fact, historically, why charts were generated? Because at that time when charts were generated, as you have seen in the historical perspective, that is in 1952 or 1960s, where there was not even calculator, not even computers. Computers and calculators were not there. So at that time, charts were very convenient. So that is the reason they had generated charts. That means they had one time sat down and calculated, maybe using logarithmic tables, and generated those charts so that every time I can use those charts. So to answer your question, the charts are nothing but the graphical representation of these equations.
And if you look at the graph also, it is the center line theta naught. So what is done is this term has been pushed to 1, so that you only have A1 e to the minus lambda square tau. In fact, it is shown here. Yeah, this is the center line thing. So this has been plotted as a function of two parameters, one is tau and other is 1 by Biot number or Biot number. And then what they have done, this fraction goes from 0 to 1 all the time. So the second plot which is there is this one. So theta by theta naught, it is essentially going from 0 to 1 again as a function of 1 by Biot number, but the dependency of the local position x by L, which you see here, x by L, that is there in that. And Biot number comes in there because Biot number decides how at a given location what would be the temperature relative to the center line temperature. Okay, we will take one more question. Jabalpur.
Over to Jabalpur College.
When you were talking about the transient heat conduction, we obtained a exact solution from where we can obtain that series. From which method we obtained that series?
It is the solution of the different. The question asked by one of the participants is that we have given a series solution. Where did this series solution come from? Of course, yes. One thing we have to admit, we have not provided the mathematics how we have solved this differential equation, which is in the non-dimensional form. We have only given the solution. So it is, we have not presented the mathematics in this solution. Maybe why don't you post this question in the forum? We will write down the complete derivation and put it across. No problem. But here in this, because usually why we have done this, because usually for UG, we don't give this solution. So that's why for undergraduates we have not given. However, as a teacher, you would like to know, it is there in many books. Actually, if we say heat conduction by Ozisek or any conduction books, if we see, it is there, but not in UG textbooks, it is there. Okay, Professor Gaitunde says that it is there in Professor Sukatme's book also. So basically, it is there in any textbooks, but if you are not able to get it, you post it in the forum, we will give you the solution, not an issue. Okay, we will move on to tutorial problem 16, problem number 16. What is the question asked? The question asked is stainless steel ball of diameter 3 centimeters. Let us write in known stainless steel ball diameter equal to 3 centimeters is uniformly heated to a temperature of 800 degree Celsius, that is Ti equal to 800 degree Celsius. It is to be hardened by first cooling in a oil bath to a temperature of 100 degree Celsius, that is T, we can take this as T final if you want, T final equal to is hardened by first cooling in an oil bath to a temperature of 100 degree Celsius.
To a temperature.
To a temperature, T final we can call, T final is 100 degree Celsius, and the heat transfer coefficient and the oil bath temperature are, heat transfer coefficient is 700 watts per meter squared Kelvin. Note this, the heat transfer coefficient value is very high. Why? Because the fluid used is oil, that is the reason. Although even natural convection is taking place, the H is quite high, and oil bath temperature is 40 degree Celsius, that is T infinity is 40 degree Celsius. What is the time required for this process? Let us answer this question. There is a second part. First, let us take this part. That is, let us, before we move on, let us state the assumptions. The first question, see, we have so many techniques which we are there. So, first thing is, we have not moved beyond, of course, we have done multidimensional, but let us go ahead and make the assumption that it is one dimensional. And we know the properties, all properties are constant. And remember, all the properties are going to vary with temperature. Nevertheless, we are going to make an assumption that properties are constant. And next thing is, I am neglecting radiation. Why I am making the statement that I am neglecting radiation? Because the temperatures are high, so that is why I am making a statement that I am neglecting radiation. Another important thing is that, now I think you will appreciate better, I am saying that the heat transfer coefficient is uniform. Heat transfer coefficient is uniform, it need not be. On the top it might be better, on the bottom it might be better. So, it depends how the natural convection is taking place. Nevertheless, I am making the statement, going the assumption that heat transfer coefficient is uniform. The first check in a transient conduction problem, the first check in a transient conduction problem is to check whether my Biot number is less than 0.1 or not. That is the first check I need to make. So, if I have to do that check, so what should I calculate? HL by K, HLC by K, and this is a sphere ball. So, the characteristic length would be volume by area, that is pi d cube by 6 upon pi d squared. So, I get d by 6. So, that is characteristic length is d by 6, we have done in the morning. So, H into, that is 700 into 6K, 700 into Biot number equal to 700 into, here diameter is
0.03
upon 6, that is equal to
K.
K is 61.
Okay, I need calculator, there is some goof up here. One second.
So, please go ahead and calculate this number. The number is going to be
700 into D is 0.03 divided by 61, that is
0.057, this is correct, 0.0574, so which is very much less than 0.1. So, that means what? Our life is easy now. That means, we are going to use lumped capacitance, lumped methodology. So, that is lumped capacitance is valid. So, for lumped, we know the temperature distribution. theta by theta I equal to e to the power of minus t by tau, minus t by tau. What is theta here? Tau is, yes, HAS t by rho V C p. So, just we have to plug in. Now, it is a plug in problem. We say plug in problem because we have to just plug in the known things, unknown things, unknown. What is unknown here? What is the unknown thing? I need to find out what is the time required. So, time will come out, that is 100 minus 40 upon 100, 800 minus 40 is equal to exponential of minus 700 into t into actually 6 by d, As by V equal to 6 by d, that is 200 it is, but nevertheless let us put it 6 by d as 0.003, it turns out that time equal to 65.61 seconds. 65.61 seconds. Now, the next part of the question is, determine the heat removal rate from the oil bath per minute, so that its temperature remains constant at 40 degrees Celsius. So, now I need to calculate the heat removal rate. We have already done this, we can go to the document back and see that relation. So, if you see that, we have got that as Q equal to rho V C p theta I into 1 minus of e to the power of minus t by tau. Yes, let us do that. That is, let me write. So, that is equal to heat removal rate equal to rho V C p theta I into 1 minus of e to the power of minus t by tau. I think it might be a good idea to calculate tau, so that we get the feel of tau actually. Let us calculate tau for the heck of it. Tau equal to rho V C p upon H A. So, rho is 7865, D V by A is D by 6, that is 0.03 by 6 and C p is 460 upon H is 700. Okay. So, if I calculate this 7865 into 0.03 into 460 upon 6 upon 700, I get 25.84 seconds. You can see that it is taking too much time to respond, because you see it is 3 centimeters number 1. For the thermocouple, you remember in the morning class we solved, it was just hardly 4.52 seconds. So, here in this problem, because that diameter was hardly 0.7 mm. Now, you see the diameter, it is 30 mm, because of which the response time, the time constant has gone up, that is why it is 25.8 seconds. Now, let us put this back in our earlier relation, Q equal to rho is again 7865 into V is pi d cube by 6, d is 0.03 cube into C p is 460 into 800 minus 40 into 1 minus of e to the power of minus t. We have just now found 65.61 upon tau, we have just now found 25.84. That means, you see how I should look at 65.61 divided by 25.84. That means, it is almost, I have taken 2.6 times the time constant. Okay? So, why? Because I want to reach higher and higher, I want to cool it to, I want to cool it to lower and lower temperature. So, the power comes down to 1326 joules. Q equal to 1326 joules. This is for one ball, but the question asked is for 100 balls. So, for 100 means all that I need to do is multiply by 100. So, that means 1326 into 100, that means 132.6 kilo joules. That is the heat removal rate I need to have in a minute. This is the heat I need to remove, so that
bath temperature does not increase.
Yes, that is the
other. If this much heat is not removed, then this 40 degree temperature bath would be increasing in its temperature. So, you have to provide appropriate cooling for the bath, so that this much amount of heat has to be removed.
Okay. So, then we will move on to the next problem, or maybe we can take some questions for a few minutes. Over to Anna University, Chennai.
So, for a pipe flow, for Reynolds, for calculating the Reynolds number, we are considering the diameter for the Reynolds calculation for determining whether laminar or turbulent.
Okay.
So, for the flat plate, we are considering the length, characteristic length as L. Why it is so?
Okay. See, actually, can we postpone this question tomorrow? In fact, in a great, the question asked by one of the participants is very good question actually. For a pipe, why do we take the characteristic length as diameter, and for a flat plate, why do I take the length of the pipe?
Length of the plate.
Length of the plate. And so, these characteristic lengths vary for different configurations. Why do we take differently for different configurations? I think we will postpone this question to convection. In convection, we are going to deal with this in great detail. So, actually characteristic length, to put it in a very just to clear your suspense so that you do not feel worried, we have to take the characteristic length actually the boundary layer thickness, but we cannot take boundary layer thickness because we do not know the boundary layer thickness. So, it is the engineering necessity which makes us use the characteristic length which is measurable, that is either the diameter or the length. But Professor Bejan in his book shows that if we take the Reynolds number defined an appropriate boundary layer thickness, no matter what is the class of the problem, that is whether it is pipe flow, that is internal flow or external flow or impinging flow or natural convection, Reynolds number of the order of 100 is the transitional Reynolds number. In fact, for different flow situations, you will get different critical Reynolds numbers. That is, for flow over a pipe, flow in a pipe, you saw the critical Reynolds number as 2300. For flow over a flat plate, you will see it is 5 × 10⁵. For jets, you will see that the critical Reynolds number is of the order of 100. Why is this difference? Because it is, because we are taking different characteristic lengths. If we take the appropriate boundary layer thickness, all the critical Reynolds numbers for all class of flows will collapse to around 100. So, the point is, we will, if you have not understood this answer, do not worry at all. We will address this issue in great length in convection.
Baramati.
Over to Baramati. Any questions, please?
Sir, in case of unsteady state conduction process, Biot number we are considering less than 0.1. So, in certain textbooks, they are considering if Biot number is also greater than 0.1, they are considering it as a lumped capacitance method. Is it appropriate or it is not appropriate? If it is appropriate, in what are the exemptions for this Biot number to be taken as less than 0.1?
I have not, the question
over to you, sir.
Yeah, the question asked by one of the participants is that few textbooks are saying that Biot number greater than 0.1 also we can take it as lumped. But to the best of my knowledge, we have not come across any textbook wherein which Biot number greater than 0.1 can be taken as lumped is stated. So, to the best of my knowledge or our knowledge, we will just stick to our value. Biot number less than 0.1 only might be taken as lumped. Anything greater than 0.1 might not be taken as lumped.
So, we know the other solution technique. So, we can solve it and see with the correct technique and see how much error is also being introduced if you assume lumped capacitance. So, that is a check for you to do also.
Okay. So, that is, we usually do this. See, we have a closed form solution for our plane wall case. You take the plane wall problem whichever we have solved. The plane wall problem, we have a solved problem in our notes. So, you take the same plane wall problem for and now calculate the using the lumped assumption and see how much the temperature difference between the plane wall, that is the closed form solution, and the lumped capacitance method solution will differ. You yourself will realize that Biot number around 0.1 is a good approximation.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, one more question. Biot number less than 0.1, as well as Fourier number point greater than 0.2. So both together are applicable for this lumped capacitance method, or only one condition is sufficient?
See.
Over to you, sir.
Yeah. Let me answer this question in a the question asked is, for lumped, whether I should take both Biot number and Fourier number together, or is Biot number enough or Fourier number enough? See, if we see in the notes, we have given only Biot number. I will answer it this way. When I make an assumption that Fourier it is lumped, then what is that I am taking? Biot number equal to alpha t by, sorry, HL by K less than 0.1. But what is there in Fourier number? Fourier number is alpha t by L squared. That means it is dependent on the characteristic length, that is Fourier number. But let me answer it in a simple manner, that is, for lumped analysis, the only non-dimensional number which has to be looked for is Biot number, and Biot number has to be less than 0.1. For lumpedness, we are not going to be worried about Fourier number at all. So we will move on to tutorial. So this time we will solve a problem. So we are choosing the problem because we have not done any problem on fins. So let us take up one problem on fin, that is problem number 18. Problem number 18. So let me read out the problem. A brass rod in the form of a fin, this is pin fin actually, 100 mm long, that is L equal to 100 mm and 5 mm in diameter. So diameter equal to 5 mm. Extends horizontally from a casting which is at 200 degree Celsius, that is TB, base temperature is 200 degree Celsius. The air temperature is 20 degree Celsius and provides a heat transfer coefficient of 30 watts per meter squared Kelvin, that is H equal to 30 watts per meter squared Kelvin and T infinity equal to 20 degree Celsius. What is the heat transfer from the rod? That is the question. There is a second half. Let us not worry about the second half. What is the heat transfer from the rod? Evaluate the temperature of the rod at 50 mm from the base of the at the free tip. So, I think we will first approach the first part of the question. So, let us take up our circular fin. So, let us just brush up what we have done for fins. Let us just go to fins. So, if you see the fins, because you see the first thing in this case is that we need to calculate the efficiency of the fin. Let us see for this configuration, how does the efficiency of the fin look like? Why? Because what are the x axis, what are the y axis I should be looking? This is the pin fin. So, this is the pin fin case. So, for that pin fin, what is that I need to calculate? That is zeta, I need to calculate zeta, and I need to calculate the another parameter which is zeta and area of the fin. So, if I get the area of the fin and zeta from this curve, I can get the efficiency of the fin. So, first thing is to do is I need to sit down and calculate the area of the fin and the zeta. So, let us write area of the fin equal to pi d L into pi d L plus pi d squared by 4. So, if I substitute diameter and length, diameter as 5 mm and length as 100 mm, I get the area in meters. If I substitute that, I will get that as 1.5904 into 10 to the power of minus 3 meter squared. Meter squared. Now, zeta. Zeta equal to L plus d by 4 within the brackets into square root of 2h by kd. So, actually here capital D and small d are same.
Sorry.
Okay, we have just used replacing like, it is okay. So, if I substitute for L, d and L is 100 mm, that is 100 into 10 to the power of minus 3, d is 5 into 10 to the power of minus 3, h is 30, d is 5 into 10 to the power of minus 3, k is 380. You note here the thermal conductivity is quite high, thermal conductivity is quite high because it is made of brass. If I substitute that, I get zeta equal to 0.569. So, if you go back to the graph, see this is the graph. So, zeta is 0.569, the curve for that is this, the below one. So, I get an efficiency of 0.8, I get an efficiency of 0.8, that is for 0.569, I get an efficiency of 0.8. In fact, we do not even need area of the fin for calculating efficiency, we need area of the fin for calculating the heat law, heat transfer rate. Okay. So, Q maximum equal to H A F theta B, T B minus T infinity. H is 30, area we just now found 1.5904 into 10 to the power of minus 3, T B is 200 and T infinity is 20. So, I get 8.588 watts. So, Q actual equal to Q maximum into efficiency, or efficiency of the fin into Q maximum. We have just now found efficiency as 0.8 into 8.588, I get 6.87 watt per meter. So, this is the actual heat transfer rate.
Why watt per meter?
No, no, sorry, this is watts, it is not watt per meter, sorry, it is watts, it is watts, it is just the watts. Now, that answers the first part of the question, that is what is the heat transfer from the rod. Now, the second part of the question is evaluate the temperature of the rod at 50 mm from the base. Okay. So, what is the temperature distribution given by? We will go back and flash the table for various boundary conditions we have solved this. Yeah. So, which is the boundary condition I am solving here?
Convective boundary
condition. It is the convective boundary condition, that is H comma T infinity. That is the first case, which is a very lengthy equation. Okay. But we cannot take any shortcut, we have to use that. That is, which is involving cos hyperbolic, sin hyperbolic and all. Let us do that. So, that is theta y theta b equal to cos hyperbolic m l by 2, m l by 2, that is right, plus h by mk sin hyperbolic m l minus l by 2 upon cos hyperbolic ml plus h by mk sin hyperbolic ml. First, let us find out m and then we will substitute that. M equal to square root of HP by KAC. H is 30, H is heat transfer coefficient is given to be 30 and perimeter is pi d, cross sectional area is pi d squared by 4. If I substitute for perimeter and thermal conductivity being 380,
4 by d,
that is right, 4 by d. Pi d by pi d squared by 4 gives me 4 by d. If I substitute for diameter as 5 mm, that is 5 into 10 to the 0.005, all under square root, yeah, I get m of 7.947. What is the unit of m? Per meter, meter to the power of minus 1, right. So, if I substitute m and L by L in the above equation H and K, I get theta by theta B as 0.807. Theta B is 200 minus 20. Minus 20 equal to, so I get T at x equal to L by 2 as 165.37. Now, although the problem is not specified, here if we ask ourselves a question, if we decrease the length of the fin.
You are asked to calculate the tip temperature also.
Okay. See, we have shown, demonstrated how to calculate the fin temperature at x equal to L by 2. Following the same procedure, one can calculate at x equal to L. So, you will get T at L equal to 155. Does that make sense or not? The base temperature is sitting at 200 and at the half of the fin length it is at 165 and at the fin tip it is at 155. So, continuously the fin temperature is decreasing. So, that is what we had mentioned yesterday. So, that the fin tip, when we calculated for maximum heat transfer, we assumed that throughout the fin surface, throughout the fin length, we took it temperature as equal to T B for calculating Q fin maximum. So, but actual temperature, there is a decrease in the temperature as we move along the length.
The material being what it is, bronze with 380 watt per meter Kelvin as the thermal conductivity, the drop is not very, very high. It is there about 45 degree drop, but it is not very high.
Yeah, this is essentially because H is also high, H is 30. Okay.
Now, I will give you a historic perspective for this problem, historic in the sense that this problem came from a student's question, saying that if I have a fin of length L and I replace it by two fins of length L by 2, will I have better heat transfer, so on and so forth. These were the questions. So, we cooked up a problem in the tutorial, so that they could understand this mathematically also looking at the numbers. So, the second part of the problem essentially is that you make the fin of 100 mm into two fins of 50 mm length. And then you are asked to calculate the total heat transfer rate for one fin multiplied by 2 will give you the total heat transfer rate for these two fins, and you are asked to calculate the tip. Yeah, so it is going to be, I will just show you the diagram here. This was the first case where this was the length of 100 mm. Now, I am going to have two fins like this. Instead of 100 mm, each one is 50 mm. Okay. This is 100 mm. I am going to have two separate fins, this is fin 2 and this is fin 1. So, what was asked is, what is, whether there is an increase in the heat transfer or decrease in the heat transfer, and we just added one more part. So, here 165 was the temperature at L by 2, let us say what is the temperature when L is equal to 50. So, it is a fin tip temperature for the 50 mm fin, whether it is more or less. We urge you to do the calculation for this, it is exactly on the same lines. Only thing that you have to take care in part B is that L becomes 50 mm everywhere. Other than that, the entire problem remains the same. So, you do the calculation for Q. Yeah.
The answer is, if we have two fins, Q per fin turns out to be 4.13 watts. So, that means for two fins, it will become 8.26 as opposed to what we had got as 6.87 watts for the 100 mm fin. So, that means having two fins which are shorter in which are half of the length is more effective than the.
And reason is not far to see, because in the second half of the fin, or when the fin is long, the temperature drops. Also, meaning you have a larger T minus T infinity, the temperature drop is more, so the efficiency of the fin is going to become less. So, that is the reason, and the tip temperatures, that is T at L is equal to 50 mm, which corresponds to this one, is
186
degrees centigrade, which is much more than 165.37, which we calculated when it was a long fin of 100 mm length. So, combination of this is going to give you a higher heat transfer. Therefore, two fins appear to be better than a single fin.
Yeah. So, this is again coming back to our tens of questions which came through yesterday. Since yesterday, ML equal to 2.65, that is all it is. So, you can relate this again to ML equal to 2.65. Of course, this is not an insulated infinite length case, it is a convective boundary condition case, but it is more or less like that only. So, that is, as you increase the length of the fin, its effectiveness is going to decrease. That is what this message from this problem is going to come out. Thanks to the student who asked us this question,
really,
and who made us realize this little point. Okay. So, I think we will stop solving problems for today. So, but we strongly urge you to solve all problems which we have not solved, that is all other problems. Of course, there are few straight problem number 12 I would strongly recommend you to solve, because it is not difficult, but it is too much of bookkeeping, but you will be able to appreciate when the area is changing how to handle the temperature distribution. So, that is important to see, because otherwise in all the classroom we have solved only the constant cross sectional area. So, this is the problem which has been cooked so that the cross sectional area of the fin is also changing. So, just please I urge you to solve problem number 12. It is lengthy, do not lose your heart, it is just simple bookkeeping. So, it is just once you formulate the problem, you have to just apply the boundary conditions. 13 and 14 are trivial, you can solve them, and of course, 15 is again a fin problem, but I would strongly urge you to solve so that you get to know how to use and read the charts for different fin configurations. 16 we have solved, 17 is also I would urge you to solve, because it is again how to use the charts you will get to know. 18 has been solved today, of course partially, but you please solve and till 18. So, then 19 and 20 is
not there.
So, okay. So, that is it for tutorials for today. We will take for 10 or 15 more minutes couple of questions before we sign off.
Erod.
Any questions please?
Professor, I have two questions. The questions are application oriented. My question number one, in case of submarine engines, the heat rejection is taking place in the seawater. Okay, sir. Whereas in case of on-road vehicles, the heat rejection is done in the ambient.
Okay.
Submarine engines, the engines which are used for submarines, heat rejection is taking place, that is, heat is rejected to the seawater. How it happens, number one. Number two, in case if it is rejected in the sea water, the heat is rejected in the sea water, because as you know, the HP, horsepower of the marine engine is extremely high, so the heat rejection is also going to be extremely high. So, in such case, can we apply this transient heat conduction problem to find out the heat affected zone in the sea? Can you get the question?
Yeah. Let me rephrase the question. The question asked is, in submarine engines, the heat is rejected to sea water. So, can I apply the fundamentals what are taught in transient conduction for determining the heat rejection rate to the sea water? But the question is little bit vague. So, where are we looking at? See, first question is, we are not directly releasing the heat to the sea water. There are, I think, to the best of my knowledge, in submarines or in various ships, they do not reject the heat directly to sea water, because we have to take care of aquatic animals. So, the rejection has to, the whatever heat is generated in submarine engines or in ships, that has to be utilized internally, and that is what is called as waste heat recovery. So, that whatever heat is being rejected, it does not increase the ambient, that is the sea water temperature, significantly. Why? Because we need to keep the aquatic animals safely. To answer your second question, that is, can I apply transient conduction, whatever has been taught. Now the question would be, where am I looking for the heat transfer? The question has to be little more specific, then only I can answer the question where to apply.
Are you saying that it is for the region just outside of the ship into the water? Can I use transient conduction? Is that what you are saying? You cannot apply transient conduction.
Suppose if the heat is not rejected, if the heat is not rejected directly to the sea water, then how it happens, how the regeneration happens, the heat recovery as you said, in case of marine engines, because some heat should go out, no?
Some small amount does go out.
Small amount, yeah, the question asked is some heat has to be rejected, where does it go? Yes, some heat has to be rejected, but that heat, how is that heat rejected handled? Okay, I can answer perhaps
physically
like
how
this.
That heat is rejected.
Yeah, so the rejection is I will pump in, let us say I will pump in large amount of sea water, large mass flow rates of sea water. If I take large amounts of mass flow rates of sea water, the temperature of the sea water what is going out will not be large. The delta T I will keep same, maybe the load is high, but Cp is fixed. So if I increase the mass flow rate, my delta T, that is the T in which has been taken into the submarine and sent out, T out, that is T in minus T out, is kept as minimal as possible, not exceeding 1 or 2 degree Celsius, then in that case my aquatic animals are safe. I think that is the only way I can think of answering this question. This is MCP delta T basically, it is M dot Cp delta T. I will have to have huge pumps to pump in the water inside my regenerators to pump in at a large mass flow rate, so that the delta T in my regenerator is almost constant. I mean the delta T is very, very small, and the temperature in on one side, that is the sea water side, is almost constant because my mass flow rate is very high. Over to you, professor.
If the mass flow rate of the sea water which is used for heat rejection is extremely high, then that may add more weight to the weight to the submarine. Then what will be the effect of?
No, you need to see, adding weight doesn't mean that I have to put pumps. Now if without putting pumps, how will I move my ships? I have in my engine rooms, I have huge pumps. I need pumps. I cannot do away with pumps just because that I cannot add the weight. Even that is true in planes. We have a compressor sitting in a plane under the wing. So here also I need a pump. I cannot say that I don't have a compressor or I don't have a pump. I have to have a pump. There is no other option. I need to have pumps.
The question is, professor, can we apply the transient heat conduction problem and solution equations to this application?
Professor, I need to rephrase the question and ask you back. Which part of the ship you are asking me to look, ship or water, which part of the submarine engine you are looking for the transient conduction? This is too generic. I would request you to put this question in forum, properly phrasing it. So let us continue this discussion, because this is becoming a too much of an open-ended problem. Okay, professor. MANIT Bhopal, any questions please?
In conduction 4, slide number 45, sir, problem in area where the air temperature,
okay.
This one, yeah. Okay. Sir, okay. This is the only for the one dimensional condition. This is the not, how to apply the two dimensional condition?
The question asked is, in this problem, is it one dimensional? Can I apply this semi infinite medium solution for two dimensional? The very fact that in the way we set up this equation, set up the semi infinite medium itself, semi infinite medium itself, the temperature is varying only with x, and that is 1D and time. So semi infinite medium solution cannot be applied for 2D at all. So that is the answer for your question. Because here for semi-infinite we have taken temperature as a function of x and t. Over to Anna University. Any questions please, Anna University?
Newton's law of cooling, which is given by Q equal to HA TS minus T infinity. At the same time we have also seen that the convection is due to both diffusion and advection, that is bulk fluid motion. My question is, the equation Q equal to HA delta T takes into account of both random molecular motion, that is diffusion, and bulk fluid motion. Over to you, sir.
The question phrased here is Q equal to HA delta T, and one of the participants says that this, in this equation, the H is taken care of by both advection, that is the bulk motion, and also the conduction within the boundary layer. I just would implore upon all participants that all these issues will get cleared as we go along in convection. It's a little premature to answer this question. I would just suggest that you please be patient with us for at least one more day. We can take these type of questions maybe tomorrow evening. Why? Because by that time we would have answered through our lectures all the questions regarding the heat transfer coefficient. We have just introduced the definition today.
Thank you, sir.
Over to JNTU. Please ask your question.
In the multi-directional conduction problem,
yeah,
we are trying to superimpose the individual conduction rates of the heat in order to find out the overall heat transfer. Now, what are the kind of assumptions we have to make in case of a multi-directional conduction problem?
K is uniform.
The one of the major assumptions in multi-dimensional conduction problem is, or for that matter, for all solutions what we have, okay. Let me rephrase the question. The question asked is, in multi-dimensional conduction problem, which we have taken as a product of the individual solutions, that is, for let us say short cylinder, we have taken temperature as a product of radial direction and the temperature as a product of axial direction, that is x and r. So, what are the assumptions involved? The same assumptions whatever we took for individual cases. In the individual cases, what are the assumptions made? One assumption was temperature is a function of space in 1D, that is x, and also it is a function of time. Another thing is that properties are constant, that is thermal conductivity in the x direction is constant. Otherwise, I cannot pull out that k from my, if you remember the heat diffusion equation, del by del x into del by del x of k del t by del x. I have pulled k from this. That means k into del square t by del x squared. If I have to do that, I have to make that assumption that k is constant in the direction of x. So, this is another assumption, and of course, I have to assume that rho and Cp are both constant in terms of time and space. Sorry, there is no space here.
Yeah,
it is constant. It is constant with temperature.
Yeah.
It is constant with temperature. That way, yes, it is space also.
Homogeneous.
Yes,
material.
It is homogeneous and isotropic. So, these are the assumptions involved in multidimensional conduction problems.
Are you okay?
Okay. Over to Jabalpur College.
So, during fixing the criteria for lumped system analysis, we discussed that heat transfer coefficient, the convection coefficient, should be low. But if the convection coefficient is low, then don't you think that the heat transfer will be less?
The question asked is, if for the Biot number, for the lumped capacitance validity, we said that Biot number has to be less than 0.1. The question asked is, don't we think that for this criterion to be valid, my H also has to be small? So, is it not an anomaly? If the H is less, then the heat transfer rate is less. That is the question.
H being less implies cooling is less, but what we are trying to say is spatial uniformity in temperature can be better achieved if H is small. That is what we are trying to say. We are not commenting on how fast or how slow the heat is going to be removed. We are saying that spatial uniformity of temperature can be a good approximation for situations where H is small. That is what we are trying to say. Yeah, in that situation, you are going to probably have a poor value of heat removal rate. And mind you that Biot number also depends on the conductivity of the material. So, if H is small and K is also small proportionately, then still you might not be able to achieve lumped capacitance.
So, another way of looking at it is, if you go to the transparency, if you go to the slide, we have put that as resistance. So, if you see that, we have put HL by K as conductive resistance upon convective resistance. So what is that we are trying to say? We are saying, trying to say that the convective resistance has to be the convective here, conductive resistance upon convective resistance. When will be Biot number less? When the convective resistance, that is conductive resistance compared to convective resistance is less. So, even if H goes up, accordingly if I increase my thermal conductivity, the overall Biot number is less. So, it is just a interplay between conductive and convective resistances. We cannot just say that H should be low or H should be high. Yes, H in general, H should be low for a given thermal conductivity. That's all we are trying to say.
For lumped capacitance
to be valid. Over to Anna University.
Tutorial problem number 18, we are using a brass rod, then you took the value of brass conductivity as 380 watts per meter Kelvin, but in data books it is written as at 20 degrees Celsius, it is around 60 to 80 watts per meter Kelvin. As the temperature increases, slight difference is there, but this much difference, how it possible?
Brass. Oh, yeah. The question asked is, if I understand correctly, the thermal conductivity of brass rod we have taken as
380.
Where is that we have told? We have not told anything.
We have taken in the problem
as 380, but actually yes, see I can always get away with the answer. See, there are various alloys, various types of brass alloys whose thermal conductivity is closer to 380. But if you are unhappy with the value 380 of brass, take it as copper. That does not matter. Copper is around 400. So, 380 is little lower than copper. But to be honestly answering your question, I think there can be a brass rods which can be made. Brass is made of different compositions. No? So, if I play with the compositions, I can still get 380. I do not think 380 is out of the world number at all. But if you are very uncomfortable with that number, you can imagine that these fins what we are considering here are made of copper, are fully copper. So, I do not think there is any conceptual problem here. Any other questions, please? JNTU Hyderabad appears to have a question. Over to JNTU Hyderabad.
When a space vehicle is carrying a satellite to orbit, what are the modes of heat transfer that takes place and which of the one is more predominant? Over to you, sir.
Okay, before leaving the earth, it is convection, but once it leaves the earth, it is in space, it will be predominantly by radiation. So, that is all one can answer, but of course, before it leaves the space, one thing is for sure, it is high speed. That is, Mach numbers are very high. It is supersonic or even hypersonic. I think it would be hypersonic, not even supersonic. What I mean by hypersonic is that Mach numbers are much greater than 4 or 5. So, Mach numbers are high means the flow is going to be compressible. It is not incompressible. Of course, we are not taught. Now that you have asked the question, to the extent possible, we will try to cover. That is, we cannot make the assumption that the density variations are negligible. Density variations are important until we get out of the earth. So, that is, it is going to be highly compressible flow wherein which the density variations are to be considered. Now, when I get out and I get into space, of course, radiation is important, but if I have to consider convection, it is rarefied gas dynamics. What is rarefied gas dynamics? Whatever we are studying or whatever we are going to study tomorrow, it is all continuum, that is continuum mechanics. That is, the molecular mean free path is much, much smaller. But in rarefied atmosphere, the distance between the molecules is comparable to my characteristic length. That is, for example, rocket diameter itself or rocket length itself, the molecular mean free path becomes comparable. That means there is one more non-dimensional number which comes into picture, that is what is called as Knudsen number. But for continuum mechanics, we consider that Knudsen number is very less. But for rarefied gas dynamics, that is in space, Knudsen number is very high, it can be of the order of 2 or 3, then my Nusselt number, that is the heat transfer coefficient, will not only be dependent on Reynolds and Prandtl, but also Knudsen number. But all said and done, the heat transfer coefficients are going to be smaller in space, radiation will dominate over convection. If one wants to nitpick and wants to find the heat transfer coefficient, the Nusselt number is going to be function of not only Reynolds and Prandtl, but also Knudsen number. Knudsen number is the ratio of molecular mean free path to the characteristic length, that is in case of rocket, we can take perhaps the nose diameter. I think that is the answer for your question, Professor. Thank you. Thank you for the day.